Hi, I'm Satyarupa Shekhar. I work with a group called Transparent Chennai in Chennai. We are a research unit and we are currently housed at the IFMR, which is a business school in Chennai. I'm just going to broadly talk about our work and show you a lot of our examples. What we basically do is use data and technology to advocate for improvements in urban governance. So very, very specifically, we try and work with agencies, with city governments that are working within urban areas. Just quickly going to run through some images that I think a lot of us are familiar with. This is actually a recognized slum in Chennai. It's called Kalyanapuram slum. This is a slum tenement that's been built by the Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board. It's an agency that was set up by the Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Act. And it's basically tasked with, contradictory to its name, it's not just about slum clearance, but it's slum development. This is a tenement that they built. And here, what I'm trying to show in the picture is a problem with surface garbage, so municipal solid waste management. This is actually a long view shot of new slum tenements that have been built about 30 kilometers outside of Chennai. Again, built by the Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Board. They look really beautiful from far. You know, it looks like the state is actually really concerned about providing housing, and shelter is a priority for the state. But we've actually made visits there. These huge apartment buildings, they don't have lifts.
I'm trying to look at the tenements on the banks.
No, it's actually, these are the tenements basically for slum dwellers that are being evicted from city centers. None of them have piped water connections. In this day and age, I mean, sorry? Yeah. Yeah, so it's not like an engineering feat, right? I mean, an engineering feat would be that Bangalore being 100 meters above sea level can get water there. It's astounding. Anyway, so basically for us, we started with this observation. It's an experience that the most pressing challenge in our everyday lives, we are basically confronted with all of those images that we see. We are confronted with them every day, right? And what we've also seen living in cities is that they're highly segregated. By several estimates, there are one quarter to two-thirds of city residents that are actually living in slums or in very, very high states of deprivation. And so this is basically the question that Transparent Chennai started out with in 2009, that how do we actually make a good faith effort to change this situation? And for us, the answer was that we needed very, very high quality data for decision makers that are actually making decisions about how to improve or how to govern cities. Just an example of slums, and Transparent Chennai basically focuses a lot on urban poverty and issues that affect the urban poor a lot. We were basically looking at a lot of the data that exists, and these are from official statistics. And we found that they actually underestimate populations. And these are statistics that governments are actually using to plan for delivery of public services. So just an example of the data in Chennai, there's something called the notified slum, which is basically that the government actually has to recognize a slum as a slum and actually pass and say this as part of their legislation, the Tamil Nadu Slum Clearance Act. And according to this, in Chennai, there are only 1,219, to be very precise, recognized slums. Right now, the census, even 2001, and now 2011 is even better, but census basically recognized that there were far more people living in slums than what the government was actually declaring. And if you actually look at how many people actually have access to water and private sanitation facilities, you'll find that the numbers actually are really much worse than just saying a slum is a slum. Right? There are people who are living in high states of deprivation, in poverty, that actually demand that the state actually pays attention to these people. And so basically what we found was very quickly, data for planning and monitoring is really bad. It's really poorly stored. It's not shared between departments and agencies. There are several agencies that work in Chennai. In any urban area, you find several agencies that are operating. They don't share information with each other. A lot of the information is actually incomplete. A lot of it is incorrect. But most importantly, what we found is that official statistics actually doesn't see the informal city. Right? So data about informal activities, informal housing, informal ways that people access basic services like water and sanitation is just something that the government, government statistics doesn't reflect very well. And in essence, what that means is official data doesn't see the poor very well. This is another big problem, that the way the state sees problems is very different from the way people experience problems. One example for the Municipal Corporation of Chennai is stormwater drains. Now, Chennai being a very, very flat city requires a very, very good network of stormwater drains that would carry rainwater from the city to the waterways, right? Straight to the rivers and to the sea. And we found that in JNNURM, for example, a lot of the city's budgets were actually being spent on building these stormwater drains, right? But the way the city saw this was just as that, as a budget line, right? How many crores of rupees have been spent on stormwater drains? How many kilometers of length of stormwater drains exist? But this is basically the way we as residents of the city experience this problem, right? And these ontological differences in the way the state and the way the residents experience problems is very, very important, because the way these problems then get addressed are very different. So basically, for all of these problems with data, this was our response. This is what we do. We collect, process, create, and disseminate maps, data, and research, primarily on neglected issues. This is basically a list of issues that we broadly work on, and we try and continuously hold the lens of data and technology to these issues. So slums and informal settlements, road safety, water, public toilets and sanitation, accountability of elected representatives, solid waste management, and now increasingly a lot more on open data and technology. Just quickly, this is basically how government, these are basically council proceedings, and we obtained these by filing RTIs, and we got these huge books which lists basically what's being discussed in council meetings, but all in Tamil, right? And it took us several hours of working with interns and volunteers to actually basically collate from all of these things and trying to cull from these discussions what could be important and what is being discussed in the council. On the left, you actually see a response that we received in response to an RTI request. In 2010, Chennai came up with a climate change action plan, and we basically wanted the documents on the basis of which this action plan had been put together. And this was primarily because when the action plan was released, we found that what was going to happen was displacement of fisher folk from along the coasts, right? So along Marina Beach, there are a whole lot of fisher folk. A lot of them basically have been housed in slum tenements, but then these slums have grown, etc. And in the name of climate change, a lot of these people were going to be displaced and evicted. And we asked for the documents on the basis of which this climate change action plan had been drafted. And what we got in response was that the document was part of ongoing research of a PhD candidate based in Kyoto, and that the government did not own the rights to share that information. Right, so this is basically, you're talking about policy, public policy, and documents on the basis of which these are being drafted are not in the public domain. Simple ways to basically process a lot of data. We create a lot of the data ourselves. We basically use a lot of GPS devices, walk around with paper maps, just look really crazy and silly sometimes. People stop us and ask us, what are we doing? We actually also get a lot of the interns and volunteers, a lot of students, residents of Chennai, actually sign up for a lot of our mapping exercises. This is a map of heritage structures in Chennai. This was important for us, even though it's not one of our core areas of research. In 2011-12, there was a Padmanabhan Committee report, which had been basically a Padmanabhan Committee had been created by the High Court, Madras High Court, to basically record all the heritage structures in Chennai. And it took this committee, I think, 2 or 3 years to basically list about 600 heritage structures. By the time they'd come out with it, I think about 150 of them had already disappeared from the face of, you know, the planet. That those structures had just disappeared. And then trying to look and locate them and actually say that they actually exist and then go back to records which exist in libraries and people's, historians told us stories that we've then sort of collated. So each point, then we just tried to basically create a layer that can give some basic information and point people in the direction of where other information could be obtained. This again was just about making visible the invisible of the city. So another question is, can mapping actually improve planning processes? And just quickly with some examples, this is a map of police stations. We obtained a list of police stations and where there were women's desks, and then we just sort of plugged that onto Google. This is an interactive bus routes map. Basically, you can click on any 2 points and then it'll give you a menu of options of buses that move closest to your origin and destination. And this was important because the company, MTC, the corporation that's responsible for providing and running bus services in the city, didn't actually provide this information. This is a map which shows road accidents, densities, and the sort of, okay, it's a really badly visualized map. The sort of circular black line is the boundary of Chennai, and the roads sort of originating from, I don't know, from the city center that you can see in Georgetown. The two main roads in Chennai are Mount Road and Poonamallee High Road. Those are the darker ones. I don't know if you can see them moving sort of in the southwest direction. So these were where a lot of the accidents were happening. And when we spliced the data, we actually saw that about 70% of the people that were being affected were pedestrians and cyclists, right? And then what we did was we actually juxtaposed the image of then the upcoming metro rail and where the stations were coming up. And we found that most of the stations were actually coming up exactly on those two roads, right? And what we were trying to advocate for was that a lot of attention needed to be paid to how pedestrians actually access the stations, right? It was pedestrians and cyclists that were getting worst affected on these roads. These are the people who are going to access your train network. And if you didn't, adequately account for them, you were going to just continue to have problems. The other thing is that these stations actually, about 150 meters, I think there's a radius that actually they say that you should develop these to enable better pedestrian infrastructure and access. And these did not seem to have them. In later stages, people say that the infrastructure has improved. This Korplet map basically shows kilometers of footpaths as a ratio to roads. And what we found, and this was obtained using RTIs, the administrative zones in Chennai gave us this data for wards. And what we found was that some of them said they had zero footpaths, which was incorrect because we walked on footpaths in these wards. But some of them said they have 4 times the number of footpaths as roads. Now that in any Indian city at least seems really absurd, right? But the point that we were trying to make here was that this is the basis, this is the data on the basis of which wards and zones are asking for more money to build footpaths, right? So we're not saying, oh, tackle corruption, accountability, infrastructure, etc. Just the way you're making these decisions, how are you making these decisions? Same story with toilets. Some toilets say they have 0 toilets, which is untrue. And some we found that they claimed that they had 16. But aside from just the numbers, what we were trying to say was that if we can make this information available to people, to councillors, they should be able to use this information to actually advocate for improvements in services.
When you say no, 0 toilets, it means government.
Public toilets. Yes, public toilets. What we were trying to facilitate was basically sort of competition at the very, very local level, right? Can people say, you know, the neighboring ward has 15 toilets, why can I not at least have two, right? Why should my ward be worse off when the money is more or less equally available? Very horrible picture, but this is the reality that a lot of residents in, I'm sure, in most Indian cities face. This is a public toilet. One is completely unusable, and the second, it's been appropriated by somebody who's running a telephone booth and a petty shop out of it. And we actually started focusing on toilets a lot. In fact, in Chennai and a lot of places, we're just sort of known as a toilet people. I'm not sure if that's supposed to be flattering, but we basically, that's a big issue that we work on. We chose this because in 2010-11, there were a lot of media reports that said, we don't need public toilets, people don't use public toilets. Break them down and free up this. Basically, the bottom line was free up the real estate, right, in city centers. And we said, you know, at least the official statistics shows that people without private sanitation facilities would be the ones, logically, at least the bare minimum, would depend on public sanitation facilities. Aside from all the people who, you know, the transient populations who want to commute to work or go to a market, etc., who would also need public sanitation facilities. And so we said, okay, you know, councillors are saying this, middle-class people are saying this, real estate developers are saying this. Let's see if there's any truth to this. And so what we did was we basically mapped where slums were. What the red arrow shows you is that there's a public toilet. So the orange ones show public toilets, and the red, the blue and the purple ones show where the slums are. And we found that there are some toilets that are located close to slums. But most toilets, where the yellow arrows are, right, you'll see there are clusters of public toilets which are nowhere near what we thought would be where people would need public toilets. So there were no major transport hubs. There were no slums, no educational institutions. You know, people, places where people would just sort of congregate at different points in the of the day. And on further investigation, what we then found out was that, one, the Corporation of Chennai hadn't built a new public toilet in about 15 or 17 years, but also it tended to build public toilets where it already had land accessible, right? So they had land that they already owned, and then they would go and build a toilet there. So there would be a ward office, and then they'd go and build a public toilet next to it, right? And what that basically demonstrated was that there was such unwillingness to acquire land for something like public sanitation, but they were more than willing to acquire land for roads, flyovers, all of these other things. Just going to skip over this. This is another question that really interests us. Can communities actually create their own data, and can they use their own data to advocate for improvements in services? This is a recognized slum, and what the gray lines show are roads that actually exist. That exist on in corporation maps. But this is what actually exists and what was plotted by the community, by the residents of this ward. And what you find is basically this whole, you know, that hatched area where there are no roads. But the point is not because that there are no roads, but that there is actually no underground sewerage and water lines. Because underground water and sewerage lines tend to run by the side of roads or under roads. And by the government not having recognized that there are roads, it conveniently avoided providing sewerage lines. This is something called the Ward Accountability Experiment. We actually got, what we're trying to do is, can residents actually create their own data, and can we actually use that data to hold councillors accountable? This is a photograph of kids, basically children in Kalyanapuram slum, talking about sanitation problems. We didn't actually start out with this exercise. We actually started out with this exercise, which was a large group of residents all coming together and just talking about their problems, civic problems. And when people started talking about sanitation problems, for example, we realized that the way, obviously, that it's obvious to a lot of us, it somehow seems not so obvious to government people, that the way women perceive sanitation problems is different from the way the men perceive it, which is different from the way children experience problems with sanitation, right? Or lack of access to sanitation facilities. And so then we had these under five kids actually telling us about problems that were very, very different from the way this group of women told us about their problems. Now, this is a recognized slum that's on the bank of a river. And what would happen is that they would obviously use the river banks for defecation, and it would be during when it was dark, right? And so the problems with gender safety were things that were most important to them. Now, what happened with the kids was that the slum was also adjoining a main road, at the edge of which there was a large stormwater drain. And that was where the children would go and defecate. And the problems that they faced were actually road safety issues, because they would get hit by vehicles, right? And when we brought this to the attention of the local engineer, he was just like, oh my God, kids never told us they have this problem, right? Because you never asked for them, right? This is the map that we finally created. This shows surface garbage. And the three areas that are highlighted were where we found that there was a lot of surface garbage. They also happened to be the three slums in this ward. And when we held a public meeting, what happened was that residents said, oh, you know, obviously, slum people are dirty. No, they're not dirty. The rest of the ward would get garbage collection services once every day. And there were some streets in this ward, in this very ward, that would get it twice a day, right? And these slums would not get garbage collection even once a week, sometimes once in twice, 2 weeks, right? And this is where basically a lot of the garbage would actually go and get dumped. And from there, it was the municipality's responsibility to then collect the garbage, right? So basically what we were trying to show is disparities in service provision. And I don't think, so I just want to say that it's not important, or data and technology are important. Data is very, very important, for sure. But what's important is actually creating the right forums in which people can use this data, right? So what we did was we actually had several public meetings where we called residents of the ward, one, to, of course, collect their own data, but also for them to engage with their local councillor. It's really easy to tell the councillor that, go clean up my ward, right? It's very, very difficult for the councillor, especially in our contexts, right, where local elected representatives are very, very weak. We as citizens don't recognize their roles, right? The same ward actually held a meeting to address this issue of garbage collection, and garbage and public toilets. These are two things that Chennai is obsessed with, and the third is roads. So you can imagine that, you know, for garbage collection, everybody and their neighbors turns up for a meeting. And they also invited the local MP, MLA, and the municipal councillor. And the councillor was not even on the dais, right? And it's just basically our misplaced sense of what we're supposed to hold these people accountable for. Why are you calling your MP to a meeting on, you know, municipal waste, right? But the other problem is that we don't even trust our local councillors to be able to address the problem. So people don't want to engage with them. But what we found was that people start engaging with them constructively, they start responding, right? So we've actually seen that councillors respond quite well after some initial time of getting over this mutual distrust. They actually engage quite well. They try and use the authority and responsibilities and, you know, sort of roles that they have available to actually affect change. We've also seen a lot of media coverage on the ground. And, I mean, basically what I think the biggest change has been is that we started in 2009, and this year we actually signed a 2-year MOU with the Corporation of Chennai to work with them to improve their data management practices, right? So this is the first time that I've actually come across a city government in India signing up with a research unit, semi-NGO, and made themselves very, very vulnerable to us. So we actually have unprecedented access to the kinds of data that they have, and we continuously criticize them on the pathetic state in which their data exists. But the fact is that they've actually demonstrated willingness to actually want to improve it, right? That's basically it. That data needs to be open, public, but definitely needs to be created by the communities.